Welcome to the Thursday, October 15th, 2015 regular Hopkinton School Committee meeting. We opened at 7 p.m. and went into executive session for purposes of discussing strategy with respect to collective bargaining with regard to the Hopkinton Teachers Association. Would you join me in the Pledge of Allegiance? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. So on the agenda tonight, we'll start with recognitions, move into public comment, and then we'll have our reports. First from the ESBC, we'll hear from any liaisons. Then we'll have a school committee chair report and the superintendent report, followed by new business. We have a joint capital project with the town to approve a capital project school department article warrant, solar panel donation to the courtyard project, ELL teacher for the district, a paraprofessional for a pre-K, school district owned vehicle policy, a school committee policy JH for student attendance, and the Irvine Todaro Property Advisory Group. And then we'll have old business. Actually, we'll have no old business at this meeting. We'll have our second opportunity for public comment, and then items by consensus. So, Dr. McLeod, do you want to start with recognitions?
I'd love to. Thank you. So I have two quick recognitions tonight. The first is that our high school was once again earned a place on the 2014-15 MIAA Sportsmanship Honor Roll. And this is a really important thing that, you know, not only do our kids do really well in terms of competition, but the sportsmanship part of this is really important to us as a town and as a community, and we're really proud of our kids for earning this recognition. The other recognition, and he's been here before, Michael Sullivan, you know that he came and received a recognition, I guess in the spring.
Yep.
There's a really nice picture. I have it here. He was one of five pre-K-12 teachers who was recognized as in this Monitor on Psychology magazine for, and it's, I quote, the title of the article is Brilliant Teaching. And the quote that they have from him is just, I just want to read it because I think that's the best way to recognize him. Michael Sullivan fosters a classroom environment in which every student can do well. And I quote, if you keep placing children in situations where they can't succeed or demanding things without giving them the tools they need, the natural animal inclination is to quit trying, he says. And he really believes in that psychological principle of high expectations and then doing whatever it is to help kids to succeed. But he embodies the message to kids that I believe in you and I know that you're going to be successful. And we know that his classes are capped out. You will say this. Because kids are excited to be there and to learn with him. So I just, again, wanted to recognize him. This is an incredible accomplishment to be chosen,
yes, it is,
to be honored in this way. And we're just incredibly proud of him. I don't know if you want to add to that, Bob.
The only thing I'd like to say is that it was like pulling teeth to get the article out of him because he was so modest about it. So we finally did, and I was able to share it with Kathy. So
thank you.
Yep.
Great.
I don't know if anyone else has recognitions.
Is there anything else that happened in town this week that we... Okay. There's no one here for public comment, and so... Do you have a ESBC report, Mr. Graziano?
We've got a couple things going on.
Okay.
So we are officially less than 2 weeks away from special town meeting. We have been crisscrossing Hopkinton, providing the presentation on the new school building schematic design to really any and all organizations who will meet with us. And we had a public forum last night here in the middle school library that brought out some people who had not attended any of the public forums before, so it gave them an opportunity to ask some questions. We're busy preparing all of the materials and data for the special town meeting on Monday, October 26th in the High School Athletic Center, as well as the special election on November 9th. The information has been well received. The questions have been great. But I think that it feels like that there's a lot of good momentum and support behind the project. I think that the general tenor of most of the sessions that we have had has been positive. So again, the questions that we continue to receive are very helpful in refining our message for town meeting. We continue to update the documents that we have with any new questions. We do have an elementary school building committee meeting on Monday, the 19th of October at 6:30 p.m. at HCAMP. So if anyone has any questions that they still have yet to have answered, we'll have a public comment section at the beginning of that meeting. So please come out. And again, we're just busily preparing for town meeting. So this is a big, big moment in this project, and we're pretty excited about it.
Question?
Sure.
About the, I haven't seen the warrant for the special town meeting, and I'm curious about the spending authority for the construction project itself. I know for the feasibility study, it's the building committee.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, you know, but that was only town money and not reimbursable by the MSBA, so I don't know what their requirements are and if that's something that needs, Ralph's not here, but if that's something that needs to be spent under our direction or under the direction of the Board of Selectmen. They're currently without a finance director, so I don't know what the requirements are and sort of where we stand with that.
So Ms. Gordino and I actually have, Ellen started that conversation with Town Hall to make sure we work that out before the warrant.
Okay.
The current draft shows it as the building committee, which is actually the model warrant article from the MSBA.
From the MSBA.
Mm-hmm. So.
So that will...
But I don't know, but that's... Again, it dependent. There's a lot of mechanics that's dependent on, right? In terms of what can actually, we encountered this with the feasibility study, is how that actually happens and can we even execute that? But yeah, that's something that we're working out with the town and council, et cetera.
Because I thought in the beginning we were voting the bills and then we stopped doing that for the building committee.
Right.
So I don't know if the building committee is just voting them and that's.
That's mechanically what's happening. Yep, and that's sufficient per council for the feasibility study. We're just checking on whether or not that's sufficient, given our town structure for the reimbursable building project.
And then I have two other questions. One is the presentation I know was going to be put on the website. I was looking today. It's not on there. So for people that can't get, the forums are over. So if the presentation, I know there's one more office hours next week. Is there,
I think there's two more office hours next week.
That was my next question, is what are the next opportunities for people?
Do you want to ask your other question while I pull it up?
So much of the sorry to interrupt. So much of the presentation is not in the presentation. So if we just posted the presentation, it looks like a lot of pictures without accompanying words. So I feel like posting it without the presentation is maybe going to be frustrating for people.
But what we might be able to do, so we can, we have that posted, we have it linked to Facebook, but I think we don't have it linked to the website, and so we can do that.
Yeah.
And also link
on YouTube.
Yeah, we just need to link it off the ESBC website. So yes, we can absolutely,
that's a great idea,
we can absolutely do that.
It was televised.
Yep, yeah, so we can do that. So, yes. Do you want to ask your other question while I...
I think my other question was, what are the next opportunities for people? I know there's at least one more.
I should know him. I had the spreadsheet open. I know. I'm pulling him.
Hold on.
I got it.
I know there's at least one more office hours.
It's a race now.
There.
Waterfresh.
It is a race.
Next.
I think it's when we... Next Wednesday night? Because I think that's when we have...
Thursday.
We have,
because we had to change our school committee meeting, so it was supposed to be tonight.
October 21st from 4:30 to 6:30 are the dinner office hours at Waterfresh Farm. And I believe there is another one that's sort of in the mid-morning section.
I'm meeting with CPAC on the 20th.
Oh, yeah. Oh, no, we don't have another one. We talked about it, but
no, that was it. But then I have CPAC. John and I have HPTA tomorrow morning, and then I'm meeting with CPAC and the trustees of the school fund on the 20th. Those are the upcoming ones available.
And then... Additionally, not the full presentation, but we met with the Appropriation Committee last night. Capital Improvement Committee is happening tonight. There will be further discussion at their meetings next week as well. So those are also opportunities to have potential questions.
So then my final question is...
you said you only had two more.
I know, I lied.
Should we keep her 3 minutes?
No.
Who's timing?
I know that... this is being worked on, but is there a date at which the tax impact is going to be available generally?
We don't yet have a date.
Okay.
So the average tax impact has been published. It's in
right.
our materials. It's for the average tax impact, but in the scope of what the overall debt schedule is, we do not have a date. It will be available. It will be available at town meeting.
Okay.
I don't know.
Possibly not before that.
It's possible it's not before that.
I just want to make sure people,
yes.
if they're looking for it, have an expectation of when they're going to be able to.
Yeah. My understanding is it will be available at town meeting. I do not know if it will be released before that.
But the tax impact is?
The tax impact is out there. It's on the Fast Facts, Frequently Asked Questions sheets, on the materials for.
Okay, so that's
for the
ESP,
for the ESPC. Yes, that's right, absolutely open and
okay,
public. Yep.
Great. I just didn't want to say the wrong information to people. Thank you.
You're really done now?
Yes. That was all three of my two questions.
I don't have a report per se. We did meet with the town to talk to them. Maybe I do. We met with the chair of the Board of Selectmen today to talk about our budget drivers. We shared with them the strategic plan and what in 2015 or 2016 would have budget implications. And then we also went through, and I don't know if you're going to do this in your superintendent report, but we went through with them the capital items that will be seeking improvement
next week. On next week's
meeting. Yeah, so we will be talking about it as a school committee next week. It is not just last year's capital improvement plan moved up a year. There are things that are coming off, and Kathy's done a lot of work with Ralph and Al to sort of decide what's important, what's not, and move things around. And so we're going to hear from her next week,
yes.
and we'll approve that. But we did get their feedback. Which will, I think, is more appropriate to share when we talk about it as a committee and when Kathy puts it out there for us. And then the only other thing, so this part is not really a report, but maybe just for discussion for the committee, and it's with respect to start time. We have been starting traditionally our regular meetings, I think, for the last 2 years at 7 p.m. Prior to that, they had been starting at 7:30. When they started at 7:30, there seemed to be an opportunity for most folks on the committee to make an executive session at 7. Now with the 7 p.m. regular meeting start time, it's gotten more difficult to have executive session before. So the question, I guess, for the committee to consider is, do we want to go back to a 7:30 as our normal regular meeting start time? So if we are going to have executive sessions, for example, something that needs to be ratified or done before, and then we need to do it again in open meeting, we don't have an opportunity really to do that with the 7 p.m. start time.
Can we not make a meeting-by-meeting decision? Does it have to be all meetings start at 7:30, even if we don't have executive session? Or
I like that.
So we can, and that's what we did today,
right?
The question is that fair to the public, and is that fair for HCAM?
So it's not a legal reason. It's more of a logistical.
It's not legal or policy, but I kind of agree. It's difficult to have sort of the variability in when the meeting's actually going to start.
Okay.
I mean,
our meetings have been, dare I say it, like relatively quick and haven't gone crazy late. So I don't think starting a half an hour later is a big problem, but I don't know how you feel about like when we have visitors come and if the half an hour is a big difference.
Well, I think generally we can do executive session at the end of the meeting. The only times that we can't is if there's something in executive session that we're going to have to then vote in that meeting. So, like, for example, next week's meeting when we're going to be ratifying the paraprofessional MOU, but we have to first take it up in executive session. But that's usually relatively quick. So I guess the question is, I know it's difficult for people to get here before 7. Is it awkward to start at 7, go into executive session, and then come back 15 minutes later? Typically, we could put most of the things that we take up in executive session at the end of the meeting and still start at 7.
We have fewer executive sessions these days, so although we're on two in a row, but so I do agree with you, and without knocking on wood, their meetings have been running more quickly. So I'm wondering, I like the starting at 7 when we can do it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to figure out how much of a, I do think it's challenging for the public and for HCAM if we sort of have the 7 o'clock start, but it actually starts at 7:15 or starts at 7:30. Tonight we did it and it started at 7:40. But there's also no one here.
We can also always do it a week, you know, if it's something that needs to be voted in the meeting. We would just have to do it at the following meeting and always have our executive sessions at the end.
I mean, I think that would be my preference. My preference would be to start at 7 and except in the case where there is something that is absolutely, we have to, we can't ratify, we can't have it in an executive session before that meeting, but we also have to vote it in the public session, then we pull the ripcord and we do the adjusted 7 o'clock start.
We're also going to be meeting almost on a weekly basis, so
true.
Coming into budget season, so if we have an executive session, and then we vote the next week, it's really a week, it's not 2 to 3 weeks in between, if that's possible. I would just, I would prefer not to move unanimously to 7:30 because of the occasional executive session. That's my opinion.
Where are you on this?
I don't want to have a variable start time. So I would like to have one consistent start time. You know, I prefer 7 because we have all, you know, we have staff here that it's a late night for. But having said that, it's not a problem for me to get here at 6 or 6:30 for executive session or for superintendent recognitions or whatever it is that we're doing before the meeting. In general, I think when it's just the six of us that are impacted, we can do the executive sessions after the meeting. I think right now, given that we still are in negotiations and that impacts the town manager who is invited, he didn't attend today, but days that he does attend, it's really not fair for him to have to come at 10 or 11 or whenever we adjourn our meeting. So I think there will be occasions until we're until we conclude negotiations where we're going to have an executive session prior to the meeting. So so again, it's not I can get here, so I feel like that's a decision that you all need to make because your schedules seem to be driving.
I can get here at 6:30 also, so that's okay with me.
It depends on the day. I don't know, I guess, again, I just feel like if we can have sort of the in case of emergency break class, we do the 7 o'clock executive session. But it, if we try, if we can, you know, try to accommodate the occasional before 7 when we need to, and then otherwise do things after.
Okay. Can I just ask one more question on this? And I think Kathy and I will work out. I hear and I agree that we consistency for start time is what we would all desire. So we'll stick with and we'll stick with 7 because we have an understanding that in general we can do all executive sessions after 90% of the time. That being said, we do have an instance next week where we have an executive session to deal with the MOU with paraprofessionals, and we were going to also review meeting minutes. So we had allotted an hour as a prior school committee
from 7 to 8.
Yeah, and so I think that's...
We can have 2.
Yeah.
Right.
Because we may need to do contract negotiations as well with the town manager, so we could do that at 6:30 and then do the executive session minutes afterwards.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Do you have the copy I brought of next week's?
No.
Okay. All right, I'll just make note of it.
Yep. I think that's actually very similar to what I think I wrote to Janine. Okay, thank you for indulging me in that conversation. And I think that the only other thing is I received several communications with respect to a policy that we're taking up today, and I think it makes sense to just sort of bring those to your attention when we talk about the policy. That's the JH student attendance policy. I received, I think, 5 emails specific to that policy, but my practice will be to talk about the communications at that time. So now, superintendent's report.
And I see that Mr. Keller is here, but my report is brief.
So okay.
Okay. I actually was also going to talk about the road shows because it's been a very important part of the work that I've been doing since our last school committee meeting. As of the 20th, I will have been to 12 of them. And it's been great because it's been, as John said, different audiences each time. We met with the center school staff one day. John and I met with Hef. I think it's been interesting because we went to the senior center, just because it's brought out different people with very different perspectives and some misunderstandings that have arisen that have really informed us in terms of being prepared for the meeting. I wanted to just point out really quickly, because it's different, that special town meeting will be at the high school. I know people are used to going to the middle school, and I know it's been widely advertised, but it doesn't hurt to reinforce that. Maybe I should send a listserv, you know, the day of, to remind people.
Yeah, I think so.
About that one. The other thing I'm really excited and delighted to announce is that it looks like we will be able to use our new procedures for voting in the Brown Gym on November the 9th.
Oh, fantastic. Oh,
and, yes, yeah, so I've been working with Jerry, as you know, since last year, and with Alan and with Al, to talk about how can we do voting in the Brown Gym in a more secure way. And she's been wonderful to work with in terms of, you know, wanting to make sure that it follows all of the code and making sure that it's a high-quality process in a way that can bring people in through the back door. Mm-hmm. So Al's been working with the DPW. They have ramp access that had to be constructed. We had to move the handicap parking. And then Alan did a walkthrough with us not long ago to talk about how we would manage, you know, the crowd control in there. And I met Jerry just today and said that, you know, that it, according to Al, it's ready to go. So we will need to make that clear to people when they come for the ballot vote. And it's kind of good because hopefully we'll get a lot of people coming out and they can get used to the new procedures that will be in place going forward. So I'm very excited about that and the much, much less impact on the children and the program within the building and safety concerns of having that wide open access to the building. So that was great. Just really good momentum. It's wonderful. It's been a lovely fall weather-wise, but the momentum in the buildings and the climate when you go in is just very positive. Kids are working hard. Teachers are working hard. It just feels like very happy places to be. I had the pleasure of spending a good part of my day today at the center school. Mm-hmm. Bob was there for an hour, a couple of hours working as an admin team, and then I spent the afternoon, I got to have lunch with a representative of 8 lovely first graders, mm-hmm. With Lauren, and then met with groups of teachers, got into classrooms. It was a really, really, really great day. And I'll be doing that. I've decided this month to take a day in each building. So I'll be doing that through the month of October. And we're also doing tabletops in every building that Chief Clark is running for us, tabletop drills. So we'll be in the buildings a lot this month, so I'm excited about that. And that's my report.
Okay, and then I'm assuming because Mr. Keller's here, we'd like to move new business item C, solar panel donation to the courtyard.
If you don't mind, that would be great. Thank you. So, Mr. Keller and Mr. Greenwood, I know we are so ahead of time, but if you would join us, that would be great. Thank you.
Jinxing us again.
Just put that a little higher, please.
Okay.
We see you a lot, Mr. Keller.
I know. I'm on a nice little roll here.
Yeah.
I feel like I should have a permanent.
I know. I'll work on it.
You can bring yours from your office.
Be careful over there. Careful what you ask for.
Well, thanks for having us here. I'm happy to introduce Dan Greenwood. Some of you may know, but Dan has been is a resident in town and works with Solar Flare and has approached the Sky's the Limit committee with something that he would like to donate to us, which are solar panels, which you had an opportunity to see in your packet. So I'm going to really kind of turn it over to Dan to talk about ultimately what's involved in that.
Sure. Thanks. So we got invited to an event here in the library about a year ago to raise funds for the Sky's the Limit, which we considered, but then I approached a couple of people and just suggested, rather than a cash donation, would you be interested in Solar Flare and my family kind of joining forces and donating a small system on the school, which would be kind of the equivalent of the cash we were thinking of, but would kind of be the gift that keeps on giving. And it would be a full donation of the system, so the school would get all the benefits of ownership. And in addition to that, there could be an educational benefit where the monitoring of the system could be available via the internet, available to teachers, available to students. And so over the last several months, we've kind of been working towards that, a few different changes in the design, but I think we're just about there, so that's why we were here to present to you to see if it was something you would be able to accept.
And I think, Dan, in addition, it's going to power, right, the facility.
I wanted to clarify. It's going to power the equivalent of the loads from the facility, but I cannot say it's going to specifically power those loads. But it's the equivalent,
yeah.
and probably even a little bit more. Should I pass these out?
Yeah, do you want me to do that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't have enough drawings for everybody, but
we can share.
We can share. Sure. Thank you.
Thanks, Alan.
I'm okay.
You sure?
Yeah.
Okay.
I've seen it. Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
So, and may I just mention, Dan, so the part of the spreadsheet that was in the packet, it wasn't the most recent information. So the spreadsheet that Dan just passed around has more up-to-date information. Do you want to highlight that?
The biggest difference is it's actually going to be overall a larger system, which is good. It's going to require more panels, but the wattage of each individual panel is a little bit smaller. So at the end of the day, originally when we were thinking of the pergola type system at the beginning, it was just going to be 8 panels, 250 watts each. Once we moved to the roof, we had a little more leeway, a little more space to work with. So we're going to be able to do 14 panels that are 190 watts each. Overall, it's going to give a 2.66 kilowatt system. And if you look at that spreadsheet, I highlighted some pretty conservative estimates of what I felt the cash flows that the school could get over time. One is the avoided cost of not having to pay as much for your electric bill. The second is an incentive that's available through the state, which is available for 10 years. When you add them both together over the course of 25 years, which I know is a long time out, but that's how long the system is going to last, it's about a $23,000 cash flow.
Wow. Dan, for the benefit of the school committee, could you explain the installation of the solar panel? That's a pretty hot topic.
Sure, I understand. So we're going to use a ballasted system that does not penetrate the roof in any way. So the solar installation itself is going to be panels mounted on a racking system, which is held in place by a concrete block or concrete blocks. It's the exact same concept as the system that already exists up there that's just beside it. And to my knowledge, there has not been any problems with that system.
Correct.
Correct? Okay. So we're going to pretty much match what's already up there. The design of the racking is a little sleeker these days compared to when that system was installed, but for all intents and purposes, the concept is the same. We're going to run a conduit, as you can see in the drawing, along where the other conduits are already installed, and there's a penetration that already exists up there for us to get down through the roof and into the electric room. We were just going to try. We met with Al Rogers. We walked the building. He approved the site where the panels are going to go, and was fine with the path that we talked about for the conduits and how we're going to penetrate through the roof. It's an opening that already exists that we would have to go through and then seal back up one time.
Great. So as a school committee, thank you. Is there any comments? We have a recommended motion in front of us. Is there any comments on the motion? Okay, so the motion that I'd be seeking is to approve the donation of a solar panel from Solar Flare, and the Clark Greenwood family to the middle school courtyard project.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, second by Ms. Nickerson.
No.
She's not here.
I'm sorry, Ms. Knight. Ms. Knight, seconded.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any discussion?
No, I just think this is awesome. I have solar through Solar Flare, and it's been a great experience. And I hope that we can somehow get the app onto something so people can see how many light bulbs they've offset and the trees they've saved.
Yeah,
and I think that kids would really get a kick out of knowing the impact.
Do you have Solar InView for yours? Or will you use the Enlighten?
Enlighten.
Okay.
This is a different one?
So we're proposing something a little different, same concept, though.
Yeah. But it's just really cool to see, the number of batteries that you've offset and carbon emissions. So I think that'd be really educational. I know there was an energy in the environment class. Hopefully that can be brought into that. And so I think this is fabulous.
To also see just, how effective it is and dispel some, when it's a cloudy day, does it work? Yes. Mm. And now they can see it works. It's just different. It doesn't produce as much. But rather than having to wonder about that, they'll be able to see.
Right.
There's one other piece that we didn't quite mention. It's not going to really add to the system itself, but because we couldn't put the system on the pergola, we were all kind of disappointed that the people wouldn't be able to see it. But what we also did was provide a non-working panel that could go down in the courtyard if everybody still likes that idea.
Yeah,
that's great.
They'd be able to, in a full size, not just a little demo, but a full size. And I wasn't sure from an aesthetic standpoint what people would think of that, and I'm willing to do it, and would mount it somehow so the students could actually go up, touch it, feel it, and have no fear of electrocuting themselves. And so that would kind of replace the look that we were talking about originally, where everybody would be able to see the panels actually right there in the courtyard. But I think this could achieve the same thing.
Yeah, I think that's a great augmentation to the educational component for them to be able to really see that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So that was one of the exciting things. I was thinking, my understanding of what we could look at was kind of on a kiosk, and the kids could go up to it. But Dan has talked about there any student with a internet, and obviously our students now have Chromebooks, can log into it and access his website, and then just see exactly how much, as you said, Kelly, how much light bulbs or whatever it's offsetting. So that's a really exciting component.
On their phone.
I mean, that's how she and I look at our systems.
Yeah.
I can show you mine right now.
Mr. Rogers is also here for questions. In case
you have no concerns?
I don't. I don't want to repeat what's already been said, but there's no roof penetrations.
We covered that one.
It's a ballasted system. They're even going to use existing conduit to bring the wires into the building, so they won't be making any penetrations into the roof. So.
Great. So are we ready for a vote? All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
I'm a yes, and it's unanimous, and so carries.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. It's a wonderful gift.
Thank you.
We gave you your drawings back in the interest of conservation.
I kept one.
Back to our engineers.
There you go.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Al, for coming out. We took it early.
Yeah,
no
problem.
Thanks.
There's a coffee issue in the.
So now we'll go back to new business item A, joint capital project with the town. This is for payment in the amount of $113,118.65. For our consideration is the request and recommendation of the superintendent to pay this joint capital project as appropriated in Article 23. There's a recommended motion on the agenda. Is there any discussion or questions about the motion?
I don't have any questions about the motion specifically, but I thought in an earlier meeting we discussed moving these to the consent agenda.
We went back and forth on it. We did, and
Ellen and I went, we as a committee went back and forth, and we did talk about putting it under consent, and then there was something that was going to stay under new business. Do you recall, John, was it
the joint ones?
No, I believe that Ralph went back to the video to see what was discussed, and I believe, that it was warrants, I actually, it was capital. I think that capital warrants were staying in the main agenda.
So we're not required to, right? That's something we do as a practice.
No, it was.
We started doing it.
I think you mentioned it
4 or 5 years ago, pulling them out and doing them under new business. As they used to be in items by consensus, and we pulled them out. Just I think because they're town meeting articles,
right.
Just so they have a little bit of higher profile for people who are watching earlier in the evening. Theoretically, we're scrutinizing just as thoroughly, regardless of where they're placed. But.
Yeah, I remember that now. Yep.
Okay. I won't raise it again then. I still think this should be in the consent agenda, but I'll let it go.
Well, it was a good comment.
I'll move to approve the payment of $113,118.65 to the vendor as indicated on the request for payment joint capital form.
Second.
Is that what you're looking for? Or did I jump you there?
Motion Sorry. By Mr. Graziano, second by Ms. Knight. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Unanimous and so carries. So, new business item B is a capital project school department article warrant number 16015 in the amount of $110,576.41. For consideration is the request and recommendation of the superintendent to pay this invoice as appropriated in Articles 24 and 28. There is a proposed motion in the agenda materials. Are there any questions or comments on the motion? Proposed motion.
This is for the tennis courts. Is this the one?
I think that's too high for the tennis courts.
It's 24 and 28.
That is too high for the tennis court. But this is the one that includes the tennis courts, is that
yes.
correct?
Yes, I think so.
I just wanted to check, because I think the tennis court one, do we have more bills coming?
No, I confirmed that with Mr. Dumas, that this is the total cost of the project.
Okay, because that's half.
Yes, and we talked about how far under it had come one night mm-hmm. with Mr. Rogers. There was some concern that the person that was doing the project added on an additional piece to it after the fact. And so we went through that process with them in terms of when he came out and looked at it in order to do the best job. But it did come in significantly lower than how it was spec'd based on some surrounding projects, which is what Mr. Rogers used. So it is almost half of what we thought it would cost. But the project is complete, and isn't it gorgeous?
Beautiful. Oh, it's fantastic. It looks great. It still says to be used in the status of the balance. That's why I was wondering if there were more bills.
Okay.
But that was my question.
But good question and good point. And no, there's nothing else that we would be using that for.
And technically speaking, in this case, we don't return it. We just
exactly.
don't borrow it.
Right. We just didn't mm-hmm. borrow it.
Right.
Okay, so I would seek a motion to approve the payment of warrant 16015 in the amount of $110,576.41 as outlined in the agenda materials.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, second by Ms. Knight. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes, it's unanimous and so carries. Next item up is discussion on the ELL teacher for an additional one FTE for the district. For consideration is the report and recommendation of the superintendent for the hire of a full-time ELL teacher to meet the mandated requirements for instruction based on the new structure of the ELL department, which has resulted in a review of student needs and increased awareness as to instructional needs. And two additional students needing ELL instruction who've moved into the district since July of 2015. So I don't know, we do have a recommended motion. Do you guys want to make a statement? Does anyone have any questions?
Mr. Berlow is prepared to make a statement.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm here to answer any questions. Essentially what happened, after doing our initial screenings this year, and just to give you kind of a lens of what we're looking at here, in kindergarten alone, there were over 40 additional screenings that we had to start the year. Once we'd finished screening all the students that needed to be screened in grades K through 12, it ended up that we have a much larger load than we had anticipated in terms of students and their needs. The state has some minimum requirements in terms of services that we must provide, and with our current staffing, we're well below this. We cannot meet those minimum service requirements. So that's where this, and looking at the number of students we have, looking at potential schedule options, it made sense to us that what we're really looking at is 1.0 FTE, and that's being pretty tight, that 1.0. Just as a for instance, we had two more students move in just this week, and both of them, in terms of ELL, your categories go in terms of services from 1 up to 5, with 1 being the ones that need the most services, and both of these students have come in as Category 1 students. So these were just two move-ins this week. So I believe this will meet our immediate needs, but I can't say that this would meet our needs throughout the whole year. This is an area of growth for us as a district.
I'll add to the comment to say that we know as low incidence districts that it's much more difficult to meet the needs of students than it is in districts with a much higher incidence, because they have entire departments and entire teaching staffs. And so for districts like our own, which has been typically very low incidence and is now starting to increase, it's really difficult. Obviously, we are training our teachers to be SEI endorsed, but that's not enough for a student who comes to us with basically no English. And it's very challenging for Hopkinton, as it is with other surrounding similar districts, to meet the very high standards that are being required of us, required from the state. Mr. Burlow and Ms. Ekwall and the department, Jill Kimball, have been working tirelessly to really make sure that we've got the data that we need to support students in the way in which they need to be supported to be successful. And in this case, even though this teacher was not funded as part of the budget, we weren't expecting the need, we have no choice but to fill it.
I have a question.
Sure.
What kind of requirements does this ELL type of position need, given, is it a certain language that they need to speak, given the languages spoken in our district? Or
maybe if we were in a different community, we might see that we'd get more of a certain language type that dominates. Right. The thing that's been that I've been amazed at since I've been here in Hopkinton is the number of different languages we have.
Okay.
So although Spanish is our most spoken language for our ELL students, it's not by much. It's only by one or two kids more than the second place. And what we see is we just have this wide footprint of languages that we see. So I'm not sure, it's not that we'd be hiring someone that would speak Spanish or some other language. We're looking for someone that can work with students where they are and get them to start to understand English. So some of that is just like you'd hire a quality special ed teacher. They have to understand where the student is, mm-hmm. be able to bring other things into play than just language. Like, we need to connect somehow. So we'd be using technology. There's Google Translate that helps us tremendously with things. But we also have to meet them where they are and allow them entry points into our curriculum. So pictures for things, so they understand, oh, that's a dog and that's what we're talking about here, or that's a picture of this or that, and that we can then create, here's what I understand my vocab in my native language to be, here's what it is in the new language, English, that I'm learning in this subject, and that's how we need to support them. The biggest challenges come, as you can imagine, as we move up in the grade levels and the content becomes very specific in terms of its own language. So it's easier when you're dealing with younger students because they're all learning English and learning new words, and you're not requiring quite as much. But when you get up into the middle school and high school, just to take a science course, for instance, it's got its own language in there that's unique to that course. So the kids not only have to be proficient in English, they have to learn that new subject. So that's where it gets pretty complicated as well.
So is this position at a certain grade level, or is it a district-wide position?
We would be looking for someone who has a K through 12 certification so that it meets our needs, because right now what we're seeing is we're getting students that are showing up here or there. We need this person to be able to hit the students where they come in. Ultimately, if we continue to grow, it makes sense, and that's why that's also a good question, to have people that are more skilled in certain ranges of ages. But for right now, there's 2.8 people in this department. This would bring it up to 3.8. We need them to be sort of someone that can do anything. That's what we're looking at for right now.
Mr. Berlow is temporarily overseeing this department just so we can get a handle on what's been going on and to support the development of the department. So you can expect a recommendation in the upcoming budget discussions in terms of what this would look like going forward. And then the intent is to return this to be under the direction of the pupil services director. We also felt that Dr. Zaleski had enough things to as a new person, and so this is how we're managing it, so that we have a better understanding of what we need going forward.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Nope, all set.
Okay, so I would seek a motion to approve the addition of a one FTE ELL teacher to be funded through the operational budget.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, second by Ms. Knight. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes. Unanimous, and so carries.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Fair professional.
Next up, we have a report and recommendation from the superintendent for an additional 1.5 FTE paraprofessional service for the preschool based on review and report of Dr. Zaleski regarding the needs of the preschool program and paraprofessional requirements across the district. And so, Dr. McLeod, would you like to make a statement?
I would. This is no different than the report that Dr. Zaleski made to you when she was here a couple of meetings ago. Once again, this is driven by IEP needs. What I am very assured of is that she has done due diligence in looking at every other possibility, including is there movement at any other level. She went in, met with her chairs across the different grade levels, looked to see if there were additional paras anywhere that could have been brought to the preschool level, and then went and spent time observing in the preschool herself so that she could reassure me that this was not, and there was no other way of covering this, and that the needs of the students are so significant that, in fact, the one-to-ones are needed at the level at which they're being asked. This was something that was really important to her, to be able to make this recommendation, understanding that this was the case, because we do want students to be less dependent, and our goal is to be able, over time, to reduce the numbers of students who need one-to-ones, and that if you need one-to-one this year, we're hoping that next year maybe you will have two students shared by one paraprofessional, and that is her goal that she shared with you, but she also shared with you that it's going to take a year to get that in place. So at this juncture, we really cannot function effectively and safely and meet IEP goals without these additional positions. So I am looking for your support in this recommendation.
We have a recommended motion. Does anyone have comments or questions on the motion?
Yeah, I just want to clarify. So this says for consideration is 1.5 and this is 1.3.
So where do you see 1.3 on her?
In the memo.
Memo, okay. So I'm looking
sure
at the for consideration is 1.5. I'm just looking here.
I thought it was a 0.8 and a point something.
0.9 and 0.4?
I just got buzzed. It might be Karen watching. Then I guess we should amend the recommended motion.
to reflect 1.3. Thank you, Kelly, for picking up on that.
Sorry, I didn't pick up on it before you could have talked to her.
I would. Then we should follow the memo, and the recommended motion should be consistent with what is being requested. So the recommended motion should be moved to approve the addition of 1.3 FTE paraprofessionals.
And where is it being funded from? Did I steal that from somebody else?
So we are looking at a variety of ways of funding. A last resort would be circuit breaker. But for example, one of the places that we're looking for funding is under preschool tuition, which is a very appropriate way of funding the additional expenses. That is the first place that we'll look. Anything beyond what we can afford in these ways, we can access funds through circuit breaker. We like to hold off on doing that whenever we can, but the funding is there if we need it.
So that doesn't need to be in the motion because it was in the last one, to be funded through. So we don't have to have that in our motion for this one.
I don't think that we have to approve the source.
No, you don't.
Okay. It was, okay.
So, Kelly, we are working on, it's interesting, and it's been a very clarifying working through this new agenda planning to get the language right on both the consideration and the recommended motion.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we're all enjoying the new format, but those types of challenges in terms of getting it exactly the same each time is, you point out, you make a good point. So sometimes I guess it will be in there, maybe it doesn't need to
okay,
be.
Okay, as long as it doesn't need to be.
Yep.
Okay. It does not.
And sometimes I feel like we draft the agenda before we get the memo, so that might be the other reason for the 1.5 to the 1.3.
But we also, I mean, so we have all of our financial policies, so we'll do any budget transfers and all of that anyway, so I think you're right. I don't think it has to be in the motion. Maybe as a general practice to put it in the consideration is cleaner, because in this particular example, you're still counting pennies in different piles.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure that's going to be dependent on who you end up hiring and at what rate. And
well, it is, and it's also the time of the year when we're looking at lane changes and tuition reimbursements and those kinds of numbers. And yet we can't hold off on making these hires. So,
So then just a clarification back on the ELL teacher. Because the recommendation included a funding, if the funding changed, would it have to come back?
Well, we'll do the budget transfers anyway.
Okay, so regardless of what...
It'll still be the operation.
It'll still be the operation. Okay.
Yeah. All right,
thanks.
So, Jean, your suggestion is to put in for consideration to the extent we know the funding source. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, any more comments or questions on the motion, which is now that we're seeking move to approve the addition of 1.3 FTE paraprofessionals?
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Birchman, second by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes, it's unanimous and so carries. The next item on the agenda is a review of a new policy for the school district with respect to school district-owned vehicles. For consideration is a review of the town's policy and a motion report and recommendation of the superintendent to adopt the town policies with respect to school district-owned vehicles.
Thank you so much. So, Ms. Scardino, so it says adopt. You said adapt, and I think that we probably, I know you will be asking if we want to amend the recommendation. It seems that given that we no longer have a subcommittee, working committee, this is the first time we've taken this up. And it could be that there are pieces of this that don't work for us. We're literally looking at the town's policy right now. So I'd suggest that maybe tonight we use our time to go through it today together and talk about things that potentially need to be changed and then bring it back to our next meeting and not vote on it tonight.
Okay.
Sounds good.
So did folks have comments and questions on the policy that you want to report?
No, I'd like to just open it up now for us to look at it together.
Okay.
So if we're going to adapt instead of just adopting, are we going to take anything out that, are we going to make it
yes.
school district?
Correct.
Okay, so then we would have to go. I didn't go into edit mode because I thought we were
I didn't
adopting.
Either because I thought we were doing the same thing we did with the remote participation policy.
Yeah.
Mm. But I think we needed to have a policy. So
yeah,
this is certainly a good start, and
yeah.
we can edit.
Okay. I feel like the difference in our work on policy this year is that we are taking it up for the first time on like mm-hmm. this as a whole group.
Yeah.
I believe that we began to look at this policy after we bought a vehicle for Mr. Rogers. And the reason we began to look at the policy is that he's the only employee who takes his vehicle home. And the reason he does that is that he's on call 24 hours a day. So that prompted us to look at this policy with respect to other town-owned vehicles where the individual takes the vehicle home. But there are other parts of this that might not be pertinent. So I guess if we just look through it.
I mean, I think before we bring it back at the next meeting, if it would be possible for Mr. Rogers to look at this and see, because it seemed to me that the town policy covers several categories of vehicles, some of which are driven home at night and others of which are not.
Okay.
And so we certainly own more than just the one vehicle. So if he could clarify for us sort of what the different categories are, and there may be some town categories that are not relevant to us. I don't know what our fleet includes necessarily. So that would be really helpful, number one, because I do think they have different categories in here. But I sent a number of things that jumped out at me, and I could probably have gone through it more thoroughly. I fizzled out at the end because I just felt like there's enough here that we really need to stop and take a look at it. There's a lot about having to get permission from the town manager for this or the other thing, which I think really needs to be shifted to the superintendent if it's a school thing. And
okay,
you know.
So whenever we reference approved by the town manager, it should say superintendent. I could just make that first indicator right here.
Right, I think so. And
yep.
You know, imputing taxable income, does the town finance department do that, or do we do that? Who suspends or revokes driving privileges, efficiency requirements, all of those things. So I think it would be really helpful for Mr. Rogers to take a look at this and tell us sort of how it impacts what we own.
Okay.
And I agree with you, and probably to that point, Mr. Dumas as well, because when you talk about the imputed income and reimbursements and things like that, I think he'd probably be.
Great. And then after that, we can copy off their homework.
Okay.
Make it easier.
So do we take this whole thing and make it into more of the format of the school policy?
Yes,
so, you know, everything is Hopkinton School District vehicle policy and limited to district employees and, you know, that.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Mm-hmm. This is a first pass. Okay. Yeah, I wasn't really looking at it from that respect because I thought we were just mm-hmm. going under the umbrella mm-hmm. of theirs. Mm-hmm. So,
well,
I guess that's
exactly what I said that we were doing. So you're right. It was only after I started getting some feedback that I looked at it and realized that wait a minute, this is going to tie our hands. And of course, we don't want Al to have to get approval from Norman, but that's what this says. So
he's also not listed as one of the roles that fall into the policy. So
who is?
They actually specifically list the roles that can have town vehicles, and so yeah.
So that
and they list the vehicles.
I thought
that
he was more of like an inspector of buildings, but you're right.
Why don't I take
match.
The questions that I've received from the school committee, and ask Mr. Rogers and Mr. Dumas to sit down together and go through this and mark it up in terms of what.
Yeah. I think it'd be nice to see I would prefer to see a marked up version. Than a new version that they've drafted, because it would be nice to see what they don't think is applicable, not just a new one that you then have to figure out what they took out.
I'll try to get a word version from the town, and so that we can provide a marked up. It might take a bit of time. This is a really busy time of the year, as you know, for Ralph, so you might not see this back on the agenda right away, if that's okay. Okay. Is that okay with you?
Yes. So what's been most interesting to me about this conversation is I didn't realize we had more than the truck that would be taken off school grounds that we would consider
our fleet,
our policy, like a vehicle covered by this policy.
Well, that's what, so when I was reading it, the town, I mean, it's talking about a lot of different vehicles and purchasing new vehicles as far as efficiency standards and that kind of thing. And so, you know, we have a lot of maintenance stuff that we own, you know, trucks that we own and are
that go off
repairing.
The school property?
Well, they certainly
they go
from one
schools,
school
yeah.
to the other school and,
okay.
and whatnot, yeah.
It talks about insurance policies and what you do if you get in an accident and
well,
all
and
that
I
kind
mean,
of
the
stuff,
insurance
too.
Is all held by the town, so I actually think that part is probably...
That's covered over there.
Although I think that again, you would report that to the superintendent. Mm-hmm. I'll just say it might be easier because I think there's going to be so much minutia from town manager change to superintendent, whatever. It might be really hard to look at a marked up copy.
That part
if there
is
could
easy.
Be a sort of
yeah.
a summary, maybe, of changes. However, it makes most sense to do it.
Yeah.
But I agree with you. I'd like to understand what from their policy is relevant to our vehicles and how we're
I don't
we're
need to see every single
it.
Time it
right.
goes from town to district. That could be done
well,
without
actually,
track changes.
Doing a marked up and then summarizing it is doing it twice. So the marked up is the easier way to do it.
Okay.
We have to do it anyway. We'll
okay.
be making the changes and we'll just do track changes
if
as
you're
we go.
Able to get the
and then you can just
document.
Get rid of them all. So it's easy.
Okay.
It's not a problem.
All right.
Okay. Moving on to item G, school committee policy, JH, student attendance. Originally for consideration was the request and recommendation for the superintendent to revise the current policy. The current policy was adopted in December of 2010, and it was discussed with principals, and it was shared through the listserv. So I received feedback mostly starting yesterday that I've shared with Kathy, and I'll give you guys some samplings. But the reason why this was taken up, and I feel like given the comments or the emails that I've gotten, the correspondence, we should be clear that the only revisions to this policy are the ones in red.
Right.
So some of the comments that I've received are related to the attendance officer, the fact that it's a crime to cause a child not to attend school. Those are not new changes, and that's actually Massachusetts law. So I think, so again, I'm going to go through the comments that I got, but I also think that it seems that maybe the biggest change is this long-term chronic as evidenced by medical documentation.
Do you mind if I make a statement as to why we took it up
mm-hmm.
to begin with? So last year, one of the principals brought to my attention some concerns from a parent about the letters that were being sent home. The parent didn't like the tone. There were concerns about, well, how come I'm just getting this letter? If there were concerns about attendance, well, I should have had a phone call. And so we started talking about the fact that we should have consistency in what letters are being sent home, why they're being sent home, and also there should be some steps before all of a sudden a parent just gets a letter. Because what we want to do is to support families if they're having any difficulties with getting their kids to school, if it's a family that is struggling in some way, sometimes kids are school avoiding and they're making it very difficult for mom and dad in the morning, and we want to help families if that's the case. And so we took it up, I brought it to the policy group's attention and was asked to take it back to the principals appropriately because you wanted to know, well, what are the issues at the school level? So I did take it up with the admin council. And what came out of that was some really good work around a consistent letter happening at the elementary level, a plan to for a phone call first when there are concerns so that the school can support the family, followed by a letter saying, you know, you're almost at the number of approved absence or allowed absences, excused, and then finally a meeting. Before we would ever involve the truancy officer, there would always be a meeting with the family to see if there's something that the school could do to help. But as you point out, it is our responsibility in schools, it is mass law, that we have to make sure that kids are coming to school. So I wanted to frame that because that was the whole reason we took it up, was we wanted to be more supportive of families,
not more restrictive. So if I could just get, I just wanted to get that background before you take up the comments.
So here's you know, what does it mean by complaint in court? Can parents be charged and arrested? You know, and then some families intending to be gone for over 20 days because mm-hmm. we're going on vacation. And so what's going to happen to me? Then the fact that this policy, or the way it's written now, with what's excused versus unexcused, what counts towards when you would receive a letter, they thought this policy wasn't very clear, and then pointed out that, right, when you have a kid who's, if you look at a school handbook, you have someone who, I don't know, has the flu or has had a fever, and you're not going to send them to school within 24 hours, but you're also not going to go to the doctor. So is that, that's unexcused. And so they felt like that didn't seem right, because you're not going to go to the doctor for something like that. And then I think we all got one about basically the authority of schools versus the authority of parents to decide when their children should be attending school, or basically trying to take the power away from parents. And so, again, I think those a couple of those comments really have to do with this last bit about the attendance officer, which I don't think is really a change that we're proposing. And I don't think that we have, like, strongly held to, other than excused absences, actually a give on that paragraph, I would think. So there's nothing new in that paragraph that makes it more restrictive. The only restriction that seems to be added is the medical documentation. And so that's something we can talk about. We can see if the administrators really feel strongly about it, and we can decide if we really need to amend this policy or just leave it as it is with new procedures in place. But I don't know if you guys got other comments or thoughts about this policy, since we do have it on the agenda. I don't think we're going to, Kathy's no longer, Dr. McLeod's no longer seeking us to approve the revisions at this meeting. So it's really just an opportunity to talk about what we think should go in the policy, if we think it needs to be revised, and what we think about these revisions.
So understanding so much of this is legal requirement. The one question I have, and this is not new, but the 7 full day unexcused absences or 14, is that, what's our legal obligation around that number? Is that prescribed, or is that?
Well, this is where there's some confusion, and I had said to Ms. Scordino, we need to look at the inconsistencies that apparently are in our handbooks. As one parent pointed out, I think I read 8. My understanding is that this policy is following our legal requirements, and that's the way it was written. I know that the 14 half sessions at the high school level can result in a loss of credit. Mm-hmm. And that's in the handbook.
We had that discussion, I think, in the handbook mm-hmm. discussion.
Correct. Right, yeah. And that's in the can, not right. will, mm-hmm. may result, depending on its situation specific. We wanted to be consistent when I said about the letters. When I met with admin, we had initially written the procedural steps of at day 5, this is what will happen. And then we realized, well, that's not policy, that's procedure, mm-hmm. and that doesn't need to be in policy. But we did include it in letters so that parents this year, when they receive letters, we didn't want the letter to come across in a threatening manner. There had been letters going out that copied Officer Phil, for example. We removed that. There was a letter that was going out prior to holidays to remind parents how important attendance was. We're not going to be doing that. So this is not meant to be threatening. It's meant to be supportive and to make parents aware that we have a legal obligation to make sure your kids are attending.
7 and 14 is in the MGL, Chapter 76. That's not like a Hopkinton right. School District number.
Yeah, so that was my question. So mm-hmm. it's important to note that the intent of the change right. is actually, we hear a fair amount about consistency of communication amongst the entire school district, and we're actually have a proposal in front of us to adopt yeah. a policy that will increase that consistency of yeah. communication. So, and then in terms of the other long-term or chronic illness or quarantine as evidenced by medical documentation, to me personally it feels like a good clarification as well, because it does give some requirement on, I mean, if you do have a long-term illness that's going to require,
that's
it's going to potentially push up against those unexcused absences,
right.
Medical documentation seems reasonable.
Right. So when we think about what, as you can see, what it used to say was illness or quarantine.
Right.
What we wanted to make clear was that it will be absolutely excused if your child has a medical condition. And you will provide that evidence to our nurse, you do anyway.
Mm-hmm.
When you come with your child, if your child has long-term or chronic illnesses, you're going to want the nurse to know about that. This is not anything that you might evidence after the fact,
mm-hmm.
but you would be providing the school for that. The other part of this, because I want to repeat that we're not wanting to make parents second-guessing keeping kids home. We absolutely want you to keep them home when your child is sick. If your child is having an unusual year of illness, that's the purpose of the meeting.
Mm-hmm.
This is not meant to be punitive. The purpose of the meeting is to have a conversation with you when you talk to the principal about how, you know, my child's just had a really difficult year. You're not going to be, we're not going to be bringing in the truancy officer. The truancy officer would be brought in a situation where it is the opinion of the principal, having done their investigation and having met with the parent, having had conversations with the parent, where these are not excused,
mm-hmm.
and sufficient effort is not being made to get your child to school. And those would be made on an as-needed basis. We are not suggesting that every time you pass 7 absences that you are going to be charged. But the policy is meant to give some parameters around what's excused and what's not excused, and then judgment will come into play in a situation where a child is excessively absent. As far as the 20 days of vacation, it's been our practice to have students, parents withdraw from school. Mm-hmm. If you're going to be away for a month, you can re-register when you return. I can't quote right here what the numbers of days would be, but that's what we've been doing.
So this isn't,
not 20 consecutive days?
No, so the example given was if you tacked on maybe an additional, so you have school vacation week and maybe you went away the week before and the week after.
So
I don't know if that's a register.
That would be taken up as an individual basis. But we do have families who live in town who've made decisions to go take their family and for all the reasons that they wanted to make as a family and go back to their home country, for example,
mm-hmm.
for a couple of months. And with the full intent of returning to live and living, still being a resident, and they've had to withdraw, because that's not meeting our requirements for attendance.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not illness. That's not what we're talking about. What we've talked about is bereavement. We have included in here serious illness in the family.
So I actually think this give, by the way,
mm-hmm.
we actually cannot do this.
Mm-hmm.
In the MGL, it is if a child fails to attend school for 7 full days or 14 half days, the supervisor of attendance may file. There's no, so what the MGL says is,
I thought the 7 days were outside of excused.
The superintendent or teachers, insofar as authorized by the superintendent or the school committee, may excuse cases of necessary absence for causes not exceeding 7-day session or 14 half-day sessions in any period of 6 months. So we could actually not excuse, right, if you read this, like the flip side of this is that you can't excuse an absence that's actually 7 days in a 6-month period. So anyway, I think we have to take that red bit out.
We have to take that out. Okay. It was never in there before, as you can see. The other part of this is that I was really quite surprised when I did take this back to the admin council to see how big of a problem this is,
mm-hmm.
with excessive absences. It's a big problem.
They were giving me data on students, and so I just want to stress that this is really not meant to be punitive. It's meant to provide some guidelines around what's excused and what's not excused, improving the way we communicate around it with families, improving our expectations around how we support families who are struggling with getting their kids to school, and understanding that it can be a real challenge with some kids who are being resistant to going out the door in the morning. It can be a battle, and we have school personnel who are there to help, highly trained school personnel who are there to help in those situations.
So I think some of the feedback that I heard was that there are rules for the 7 days and the 14 half days, and then there is excused absence, and then there is opinion on whether you go any further or not. And just the gray area in there was causing a little discomfort. How is, if I leave 3 days early for my vacation, are you going to say that's okay? But then somebody else says they're going to take a week off for their vacation and that's not okay. You know, so I think it, I don't know how to address that in a policy, but it seemed like there was still some discretionary decisions being made. I mean, if there's no meeting, if the meeting is just to say, why are you out so much because we're on vacation, you know, that I think was a kind of a discussion point that I was hearing was how, what criteria is used if they're not excused to, I don't want to say allow, but
to not apply.
Right. I mean, if it's like we had a really bad flu, it went through the whole family, we were out for 2 weeks, or, you know.
So I guess my answer to that would be to say that that's why we hire really good school leaders.
Okay.
We have to provide them with being able to use judgment, and they know the families really well.
Okay.
And they know the children. So I truly am not, although it says the superintendent, I mean, this has never been brought to appeal to me. These are building-based conversations and discussions, and always in the interest of supporting families and in making decisions jointly with families that are in the best interest of children.
Okay.
So I have a question and a suggestion. My question is, can we also include in the policy cross-reference the school handbooks, because there's information in there related to this that, and that's policy once we're there approved. And then, you know, just as I'm listening to this conversation, I'm wondering, you know, if a sentence can be added that, while not explicitly outlining the procedure that they're going to go to, at least makes reference to the fact that, you know, there's no reference in here that you'll be contacted, that the principals will be initiating a conversation, an ongoing conversation with parents before they get to this denial of school attendance and attendance officer section. So if there's some sentence that we can craft that basically says, you know, principals will monitor and communicate with families.
Before the attendance officer part, probably.
Even before denial of school attendance.
Yeah.
It kind of flows off of that sentence about the parent's responsibility, too. You could add in.
Tell me where we are.
As written in each school's handbook, parents shall provide an explanation for a child's absence. If you put something right after that sentence about...
Basically, that the individual schools will be in contact with parents via phone, letter, or meeting in advance.
And or
meeting in advance of a denial of school attendance or or the attendance officer being contacted or something. And we don't have to wordsmith it exactly right now, but...
This is as time as any.
Yeah. Because I don't understand exactly all the steps, so I don't want to say it the wrong way, but just some reference being made to sort of soften it a little bit and put it right there, out there to parents that you don't...
Just to discuss any concerns for absences.
Yeah, because...
Or regarding
you
absences.
Don't, it sounds like one of the main concerns has been, wait a second, how come I didn't know about this till it was a crisis? So a lot of steps are now being consistently applied across the buildings to make sure that that's... So just some reference.
Speaking kind of to the positive intent that you've alluded to.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I will cross-reference school handbooks, and I will also check that the language in the school handbooks is consistent with the language in the policy.
And I do think we should talk about whether or not, so if we are going to revise this policy, I think we should talk about whether or not it's only an excused absence if it's long-term or chronic illness.
Yeah. So because like a regular sick day is not an excused absence?
Like being sent home
under,
by the nurse.
If we change it this way, it's no longer an excuse. So if
right.
your kid
20 or 7.
Had, well, if your kid vomited in school one day and then they send them home, your kid is not allowed back the next day. And they know they're sick, right? I mean, they don't want them back. They've told you to not send them back to school for 24 hours.
Mm-hmm.
That's not going to be an excused absence.
Mm-hmm.
That just seems, it's not a long-term or chronic illness, but we're actually telling you your kid can't come back to school, but we're also saying that's not excused.
So where do you think the number 7 comes from in MGL? It feels like an average to me. It feels like that number seems like a reasonable number when you look at 185 days that a child might be sick.
It's not even 185, it's half of 185 because it restarts every 6 months, right? So within
right.
6 months, they expect
there
that
you
you'll
go.
Be stomach flu for.
That's
yeah,
why
I've does,
7
does
days.
One, I guess the question is: have we sort of invalidated the excused absence issue anyway? Because as you pointed out, the 7 and 14 limit has nothing to do with whether they're excused or not.
Mm-hmm.
Well, so I'm not thinking about, you know, my child who doesn't care if their absence is excused or unexcused, right?
Right.
It does not actually weigh into, it's not going to upset them. But I imagine that a high schooler, so maybe they haven't been sent home, but they went home because they had a stomach bug on a Thursday, they're going to feel that because it's not an excused absence, they need to get themselves to school.
Yep.
I think it's just the term, what's excused and what's not, and I think that you're right. We still keep this down here with 7 days because it doesn't really matter, excused or unexcused. It's 7 days.
Mm-hmm.
Whether you had a one-day illness every week for 6 months, and so you got you're
right.
well past the 7 days, so we're going to say, what's wrong with this kid every Monday? I don't know. I guess so. For me, it's the term excused, and I think it has like a psychological effect on maybe older children as they're looking at.
Which
I don't know.
Yeah, I would have to. I have to look at the high school handbook because I didn't do that before this meeting. But also, high school and middle school, because they're on a rotating schedule. Is it a day or is it a class period? I think there are differences.
Yeah, I think it's by class, like
by
missing
class,
certain
right, because
numbers
so
of
classes. You can miss a day of school and not miss a class,
yeah.
one or two of your classes, depending, or more if you're in the middle school. And I'm not facile enough with that in my head about how that works.
Parents.
I'm not suggesting we have to change this, but I'll just go back and read it before we discuss this again. Because I think you're right that there may be differences at the secondary level versus the elementary. It's a little more straightforward at the elementary level.
So what I hear Ellen suggesting is that another bullet, that we leave the bullet about long-term or chronic with the medical documentation, but that we reintroduce a bullet or add a bullet now that will allow illness as an excused absence.
Is
because
that what
we
do?
Well, we kind of took it away. It was there before. It just said illness
or
quarantine.
Oh,
and by saying, by
changing
defining
it
to long-term or chronic.
Right.
We kind of took away the child with the flu that goes home with a stomach bug
or lice. I mean, let's talk about lice. That's 3 to 4 days right in a row. Mm. So you actually could.
Well, it doesn't have to be if you've been treated.
We haven't had it. I don't actually really know about.
No.
But
yes.
No, I think it takes a couple days. Yeah.
It takes a couple of days.
Listen, four
you
girls
don't
with
deal
long
with
hair.
It. Yeah.
Oh, I dealt with it as a principal
oh,
and as a mother.
Oh.
I've recently heard that it's...
But that's anyway. Good, you don't go to the doctor necessarily, or you don't get a note necessarily for that.
So the idea is...
I'm thinking, like, concussions, you would be, you'd have a doctor's...
You would.
You'd have medical...
We truly don't want to encourage kids with colds to come in and then have a whole class.
Well, even on the recording, the school nurse, if they have a fever, you need to say that, or if they have any symptoms of the flu, we're about to get that recording too, right? So, so you wouldn't necessarily go to the doctor, but you are specifically, whether you've been sent home the day before or not, you're specifically directed not to send your child on those days.
Mm-hmm. Give them some Tylenol and.
Yeah.
No non-excused absence for you.
So, yeah, I think if we're currently giving an excused absence for illness, I don't think we should back off of that.
So we would be taking out that red, too, so there we're down to no?
No, I would leave that red. I think it's really important that we added that in as that was something different. But by adding the red, we lost the just illness.
Just illness,
so
right.
I think we could just add a bullet that says illness.
Why wouldn't we just go back to illness or quarantine?
Because then we haven't changed the policy at all. We might as well not take it
off. That's kind of where I was going.
It sounds like what the principals want to add in this piece about medical documentation for long-term or chronic illness.
Not necessarily, not they if you're going to take out the long... If you're just going to leave it back at illness or quarantine, then no.
I think we've crossed out all the red.
They were not. So I think what we said is that that documentation is provided anyways, right? I mean, that anybody whose child has a long-term or chronic illness is providing that information to the nurse when they register their child at the beginning of the year. Or if it's not at the beginning of the year and it's a concussion or something, that documentation is going to be provided. So,
I think by taking out this red, this doesn't hold as much water.
Yeah, to your point of making it...
You're still going to do...
excused absences, take out the long-term and chronic and medical documentation.
Maybe we just shouldn't have a policy on student...
You're still going to do the outreach, and that's procedure, not policy. And so really the procedure change is more important than...
And as we discussed, I mean, that's why we're doing this, that's why we discuss policy, is the reason it came up anyway is it came to my attention... through a principal because of parental concerns about the procedures. So we've looked to change the procedure. That's been done and is now going to be in place. So
I guess the only change could possibly be the additional positive intent language that will be added between the as written and the denial of school attendance. So that would really be what we focus on instead of where the red is now. It would be more around we have procedures in place that will be doing some outreach at these certain times. And
but now I feel like that's procedure and you're making it policy. And if that's the only thing that's being added, then, I feel uncomfortable when policy dictates procedure in terms of these are things that are in place. We've improved them. That's an important thing. We've responded to parents, but not because the policy told us that we had to.
I thought we were doing that. That's why I thought you had taken notes that we were adding something in there.
So. But if that's the only thing that we are now changing in this entire policy, it feels like it makes more sense to just leave the policy as is. That we took it up, we looked at it, we decided that it's working the way it's been in place for us. We've improved procedure through communication.
I'm fine either way.
Yeah. I think what you're saying makes sense.
Oh, but you were going to reference the handbook.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think you can add that to the grid without
doing a.
You don't need to vote on that. It's just
maybe what we do is we reference the handbook, make sure that we're consistent in our handbook language with policy.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's been a great exercise because clearly you've added consistency where maybe there was some variability. And
as
so
to
I
the
think
principals,
that's great.
I mean, it was they appreciated it too.
Yeah, so I think that that's great, and I really do think it's important to include the handbook, but, other than that, it sounds like the policy, the way it's written is...
So how do we do that? Do we write under adopted as written? So
well, we've just
taken
don't
it up.
Or we're just not going to take a motion. We're not, yeah. There's no motion, we're not.
But does it stand in the records as a first reading on October 15th, 2015?
What is that?
Doesn't that have to lead to...
No, because that's not the first reading of the policy that's going to exist.
Okay.
Yeah, because we didn't...
That takes off.
Yeah. I would take that off.
Okay.
Okay.
Great. Thank you.
Next step is we need to select appoint a representative from the school committee to the Board of Selectmen's Irvine Todaro Properties Advisory Group to represent the school department. And so, actually, the way this is written, it might not be the way I just said it.
Okay.
Is this a request to appoint a person from the school committee?
No,
or
just a
appoint
member.
A person, period?
Appoint a member. So you
okay,
could
so I'm trying to distinguish between appointing a member of the school committee
yeah.
versus appointing a member from the school district.
Oh, so my understanding from the Board of Selectmen was that the member could be the superintendent. You could decide that you want me to represent the school committee with that group, or it could be one of the school committee members.
But it could not be both?
I don't know. It says a member to represent the school department. So what they're looking for is long-range planning and the input of the school department in that conversation
yeah.
around how we're going to use this property over time.
But to your question, I don't think it can be both. I was at the meeting when they were talking about this, and they were really wrestling over the number of people. So they're not looking for us to throw two people at them and make it an even number. So.
But that person then would bring back and report back
absolutely.
To the full.
But to your point, I don't think you would have a superintendent and the school committee member.
I don't feel strongly about it. I just am offering that I would do that if you wanted me to. I would be willing to do it. It's not something that I feel strongly that I need to be part of. But I just know that the conversation's an important one. So
I don't think it's part of your goal. This is my feeling on it. It's not part of your goals. It's actually not something you're going to get. And so you can, if you're like, I really want to do it, I think this, because otherwise I think it's just an extra with little benefit for you as the superintendent.
Okay.
But then I think, well, I'm also not, because this is going to go past May.
Right. It's a long range
so
planning.
I'm not sure.
So it's hard to put a school committee member because of the...
But it's not. I mean, we would just change the member.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think also to the point in terms of obviously the school committee member or superintendent is representing the interest of the district, but I also think this is going to have sort of potential broader community uses, so I think it might make sense in that case to have a member of the committee since we're also residents of the town, not suggesting less investment, but, to that point.
No, I think so, too. Yep.
Does it say in here that it's not that it's going to extend past May town meeting?
I have no idea.
That was a really nice try. I'm just saying.
No, I don't know.
It may very likely, but it's not necessarily set up that way.
I will not shirk responsibility. I'm happy to do it. I'm not on the ESPC, which I think takes a lot of time, and I also don't want to conflate the two committees as we're working on like two projects that.
It'd be a weird message, too,
right.
I think, with the vote coming up.
So
I feel the same way. I'm very interested in it, but I feel, I don't feel like it's...
I mean, I'm happy to do it, too, but...
Because the 300th committee is over.
you're bored now.
Well, it isn't, but... no, I mean, just, I think that the long-term planning is critical, and that's what we hear all the time from the town, rightfully so, what's the plan, what's the plan, what's the plan for all of this stuff. So there's going to be, this is different than what are we going to do with the center school, assuming the vote passes, right?
Yes.
There's a separate committee, do we have representation on that?
They have not yet created the committee.
Okay. So we might all have the opportunity to serve on a on a committee.
On a property committee?
Yes.
Okay.
At some point.
So I think, I mean, Lori's not here, and maybe negotiate. I will take this on, knowing that someone else will take it on in May. If it's still going on.
I'm happy to do it, too, if you're not comfortable.
Because then you can do the negotiations and the teacher negotiate. We can finish that stuff and that hard work. And the charter is also going to happen. You're already going to be hanging out with these people. I'm saying that fondly. I think it's going to be great. So
I think it's going to be really good.
I think it's going to be interesting and fine. And part of our conversation today was about a parking lot. And
But you're going to be hearing more about that next week.
Right. So I think everyone's on board.
We are going to be proposing it as part of our capital planning.
We are?
Yes, we are.
Oh, I'm going to save my comments for next week.
Okay.
So can I
yeah, go ahead.
Move to appoint Ellen Scordino to the Irvine Todaro Property Advisory Group? Is that what just happened?
Until May 18th. I'm just let me get the exact date.
The project.
So we're going to be like Nancy now. Now we're counting the meetings.
Yes.
I think Ellen just said she's not running again.
I've been doing it since I just...
I second that motion.
Okay, all those in favor?
Yes.
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 Yes. Okay, unanimous and so carries. I am our representative on the Irvine Todaro Properties Advisory Group.
I think your first order of business needs to be to get a better acronym.
Yeah. ITPAG?
Yeah. It doesn't really roll off the tongue.
It will. Just say it a few more times.
I don't want that T-shirt, so... Lucky for you.
Tag it. Okay. We have no old business. Nobody's here for public comment. Move to items by consensus.
Yes, we do. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve the operating budget and other funds warrant number 16-014 in the amount of $560,088.68. The superintendent recommends the school committee vote to approve $12,440.25 from the Sky's the Limit fundraiser be placed in the middle school gift account as indicated in the agenda materials.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Birchman, second by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
It's unanimous and so carries. So currently our next meeting is scheduled for October 22nd. And it's currently scheduled to start at 7 p.m. for our regular meeting, and we'll do our best to make that happen, give or take 15 minutes, if we end up needing to do the MOU before and folks can't get here at 6:45. And so I'd seek a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, second by Ms. Knight. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Unanimous, and so carries, and we're adjourned at 9:17.